This is Whitley Strieber, and this is a Dreamland video presentation. You have reached the edge of the world. Well, today we have an incredibly special guest, and it's been a long journey in my life to the point where I am sitting across the space of Zoom with Kathy Davis of Intruders. Kathy's real name is Deb Jordan Kauble, Debbie Jordan Kauble. And she has written what really is the book of a lifetime, Extraordinary Contact, Life Beyond Intruders. I can't remember the time I was... a time I was more moved by a personal encounter testament than I have been by this book. It is a real masterpiece of delivering a person's life in their own true voice. And I absolutely urge you to get this. I don't usually sell books like that on the show, as you all know. But this is so special, and there is so much wisdom here and so much knowledge. And the other thing is, it's a big story. It's a tragic story. It's a story full of wonder. It's a fun story. It's all kinds of different stories, all wrapped into one. Debbie, welcome to Dreamland and congratulations on this extraordinary book called Extraordinary Contact.
Thank you so much, Whitley. I am so happy to be here. I'm so happy to be talking to you about it. And I'm so grateful for all of your kind words. It means so much to me. I can't even, there's no words. So thank you.
It brought me to tears a number of times, and that doesn't usually happen with this old codger. So let's start out. We're going to build a story through the hour and a half we're together. And let's start out. I think the place to start is probably the mark in the yard.
Yeah, that's June 30, 1983. That's the event that led me to Bud and really was a pivotal turning point in my whole life and in me. I changed that day, that and I didn't even realize it at the time. I was a young single mother and I was living with my parents. Had just moved back home with them after a divorce and listen to me, I was fixing to, they owe me. I was about to go do some sewing with a neighbor to help make a little extra money. So I was washing my hands at the sink and I looked out the window and I noticed a strange light in the pump house of the swimming pool behind my parents' home. And at the time, I didn't really realize what the light, why it struck me as odd. But later I realized that it was not really quite the right, it wasn't the right color. More of a whitish light rather than the incandescent bulb that was in there. And I made note of it. And I told my mother about it. She told me not to worry. So a couple minutes later, when I got ready to leave though, I decided to just take one last look around the back in my car on the turnaround before I went to Deanna's house. And when I did, I noticed the light was out. The pedestrian door to the garage that was attached to the house was open. But I didn't stop because I was just one street over. So I called her when I got home, or when I got to Deanna's, I called her and told her what I'd seen. And she said not to worry about it. And so I hung up and the phone rang. And immediately I picked it up and it was my mom asking me to come home right away. And she sounded kind of strange. She sounded scared and my mom was never scared of anything. Even my girlfriend's husband heard me speaking to my mother and he says, tell her to call the police. That's what they get paid for. And she heard him and said, no, I want you to come home now. And I'm like, ooh, okay.
So that would get you moving.
I got a little goosebumpy, and I still get a little goosebumpy every time I think about it. You know, it's been 38 years this last June since that happened, and I still get a little goosebumpy when I think about parts of it. So anyway, I go home, and I proceed with an unloaded shotgun to go look around in the backyard. That in and of itself was way out of character for me, because I was definitely not a brave person back then in my early 20s. I may do that now. It's a lot harder to scare me now than it was then, but nevertheless, I did it. I went out, looked around, didn't see anything, did find my dog under my dad's ladder truck, but she would not come out to me. And I went into the garage looking for a prowler. I never in my wildest dreams thought about a UFO or aliens or anything like that. I was thinking that someone was going to break in my mom's house, and my little kids and my mom were there alone. Daddy was working second shift. So anyway, I'm in the garage, and as I began to realize there wasn't anyone in here, I started to feel weird. I felt hot. And I remember thinking, oh my God, I have to get out of here right now. My body was on fire. And as I headed towards the pedestrian door, which was open, as I reached the open door, something hit me in the chest. And it was like a literal physical punch. The light was so bright and intense that I know my eyes were shut, but I could still see it. And I felt everything. I mean, it felt like every single individual molecule of my body was vibrating independently of each other and almost pulling apart. And I felt like time stopped. And I don't have the good words to really convey exactly what I felt and thought, but I don't know that I could have survived that for very long. So surely to God, it couldn't have been more than a second or two. And I remember thinking, oh my God, I'm dead. I'm dead. This is what it feels like to be dead. The lights stopped being so intense. The vibration gradually stopped. And I found myself out on the patio, kind of a few feet out from the doorway. And I couldn't move, but I could move my eyes. And I could see movement in front of me, but my eyes were just blown at that point. Like if you've gotten your picture taken by a bunch of people with flash cubes and you didn't get you didn't blink in time, and you know, all those white splotches in your vision. And I couldn't, my vision was all splotchy, but I could see movement. And I thought I saw like six children in my mom's backyard coming from all points in the yard. And I thought, what are all these kids doing in this yard? And I could feel something. At one point, I felt something pulled down on my shoulder. And in my mind's eye, it felt like a hot knitting needle was in my ear all the way through to my head. And I couldn't scream, but I heard a voice, didn't see anyone, but I heard a voice say it was unfortunate that I had felt this pain, kind of matter of factly. And at one point I noticed a ball of light out in front of me, maybe 20, 25 feet. And it looked about the size of a basketball, and the light was much softer. I mean, I could look at it and it wasn't painful. It was about as high off the ground as I am tall, which is 5'3". And it moved down very slowly, and it went up very slowly and stopped where it started. And I felt like it was looking at me. I don't know why I had that impression, but I felt that it was looking at me. And about the time the little kids in the yard were all moving together in a line off to my right and started to basically kind of glide down in front of me, that's when I saw this thing in the yard. Now, for the last 38 years, we've called it a craft for lack of anything else a better way to describe it. But I don't know that it was something anybody got into and flew away, because like I've said, even six little children in this thing, they would be so crammed together, I can't see. So I don't know what this thing was, but they went into it. And it wasn't much bigger than the pump house of the swimming pool. I'm going to say maybe it was 10 feet tall at this height, egg-shaped, bigger in the middle. And it had like four appendages coming off of it, coming out about the middle of it. that went down to the ground, but they were really too skinny to really be, to bear any weight. I felt they were more for stabilizing because I really felt like this thing really wasn't exactly all the way on the ground. Like it was just like right above it. Cause I got this very subtle feeling that it was moving somewhat. Now, I don't know if that was my eyeballs were messed up or if I was actually seeing that, but I felt like it reminded me of when I look at a bobber, when I go fishing with my kids and I see my little red bobber on the smooth, glassy lake where it just barely moves, you know, because you watch that bobber real close. That tells you you got a bite. But it kind of felt like that. So this whole scenario I just described to you, thing, it maybe only lasted 10 minutes or so. And then, at least that's in my mind. And then I hear my name. Well, first I thought, oh my God, my kids, because I realized my kids are in the house. And immediately upon that thought, another one came into my head that said, your kids are fine. Your children are okay. Then I hear my name. And as when I heard my name being called, it was like someone snapped a finger. And what I just described to you was gone out of my mind. And I remember turning and making my way across the back patio up the steps to the upper porch where the kitchen was, and Mom was in the doorway. I later found out that the voice I heard call my name was actually my mother. And that was the snapping of the fingers when I woke up or whatever happened to me. And then she said to me, is everything okay? And I said, yeah, everything's cool. But in my mind, I'm thinking, ugh, I feel weird. I was thinking, ugh, I feel weird. I feel like I got to get wet, you know? And I'm thinking, okay, we got this awesome swimming pool out here. It's like almost July 4th. So I go back to my friends and I'm like, how about instead of doing this tonight, let's go swimming. And she was like, okay. Oddly enough, it was later determined that I was probably gone an hour and 15 minutes or so, give or take. But yet, even the people whose house I left, it's almost like they got turned off too. They weren't actually even aware of how long I was gone. And later when she was interviewed by Bud, she's like, if I'd have realized that, I probably would have been worried. But it didn't dawn on them either. So her daughter and I went back to Mom's. And as we're walking across the backyard, her daughter steps on something. Well, we think she stepped on a bee, you know, the way she reacted, but we couldn't see anything. So we got in the pool and we're all feeling kind of nauseous at this point, a little queasy. I've got about a headache and my eyes are starting to really get weird. And I'm noticing the lights, you know, it's dark now, the lights on and around the pool and up the driveway and everything's got a white halo around it. And, you know, my eyes burn. I just feel weird. And my friend, she's like, well, let's go to White Castle. If you're from the Midwest, you know what White Castle is. They're open all night.
Yeah, you don't have to be from the Midwest. I have a White Castle Jones myself. And unfortunately for me, they now sell them in the refrigerator, the freezer section of our local grocery store.
Yeah, they do, but they're not exactly the cure for nausea. So I don't know why she thought maybe let's exactly. Go have some White Castles. And I'm like, okay. Well, we headed off in that direction, but we aborted it. I believe we decided against it and they went home and I went home. The next morning when I woke up, my eyes were swollen completely shut. Now, keep in mind, I have no conscious memory of whatever happened the night before. And I'm miserable. So my mom took me to the emergency room. And in the emergency room, there happened to be an actual eye doctor, an ophthalmologist, I think that's what they're called. Not an optometrist, but the actual doctor. But he said, I have an office across the street where I can examine you better than I can here. Can we take her over there? So my mom took me over there. And the first thing he asked me is, have you looked into the arc of a welder's torch? And it really shocked me that he would ask me something like that. I'm sure I looked at him like he was crazy and said, no, you know. And he said, and I don't remember a lot about it, but I remember him saying, I'm surprised that your eyes didn't hurt before today, as bad as they look. Well, they didn't. drops and pill, or I had multiple drops and some gel stuff that I had to use in them. And from that point on, my eyes were never right again. And my vision was never really as good as it was before. And a side note, in my 30s, I was diagnosed with cataracts and macular degeneration. And by the time I hit 50, I had all new lenses implanted. And my macular degeneration remains dry and stable, thank God, but my vision has never been right. And I have all these eye allergies that we just talked about a little while ago. You know, I have to use eye special drops and everything.
You are preaching to the choir here. I have the same allergies, and I've lost some vision in my right eye because of exposure to an extremely bright light that I really can't explain. So not enough to be debilitating, but it's, you know, enough to be annoying. So yeah, this business of vision issues is not uncommon in our experience, especially the people who get exposed to that very, very bright white light.
And interestingly enough, after that, which is not even in my book, and this is something I don't really talk about, but I developed something called, here just recently, I developed something called ocular migraines. And because I have so many eye issues, the doctor was very worried about it. So, and he said, your eyeball looks normal. So he sent me to an ocular neurologist in India, one of the best.
I've just been with an ocular neurologist. How strange. Go ahead.
Well, I would see these things. They look, and it's usually in the left eye. It looks like a kaleidoscope, a prism of color. It will begin with a flashing, and then I see the prisms and kaleidoscope, and then that lasts about 20 minutes, and then they go away, and I'm like blind in that eye for about 20 minutes. It's annoying. I don't really have too much of a headache with it. It's mostly affects my vision. So they did every test known to man, and they also did an MRA and a CT of my brain and neck, and they noted the area of my visual cortex, I guess, where the eye is, I have a signature of, or like a scar tissue that sometimes migraines can leave. She said it wasn't anything concerning, and that I don't have them enough to warrant medication, but they are annoying because if I'm driving when I have one, I have to pull over because I can't see. Usually it's, I can't see out of my left eye. Only once has it been both. I mean, I recently started that, and honest to God, Whitley, I believe with all my heart, no one else in my family had these issues, except my older sister does have wet macular degeneration. But other than her and I, you know, and she's had experiences, nobody else in my family, blood family, has these issues, and I will forever go to my grave believing that what happened to me that night on June 30th is responsible for this. Now, I don't think that whatever I had contact with intentionally harmed me. I feel that it was inadvertent. I don't think it was intentional. You know, I just wish some people I've heard say that they've been cured by them. I wish they'd come fix me. You know,
yeah,
I got
I've
a little list.
Same thing with my eye, precisely, because what happened to me is a result of my efforts to work with this and understand it. And just as what happened to you is a side effect of something that they did that you had no control over. But so far, so bad in terms of curing my eye.
Yeah. Well,
I guess you're the same situation.
Me too. If I get any luck, I'll send them your way.
Oh, please do.
Yeah.
Please do. Let's see. Let's take a short break, free Dreamlanders, for you. In fact, we're not actually going to take a break this time. And this time I'm just going to remind you of what goes on at Unknown Country and what's going on in this show. Debbie's book is Extraordinary Contact, Life Beyond Intruders. It is one of the great testaments of the close encounter experience ever written. It is written in her true voice, and that is so rare in this world. People hide their voices from their writing just instinctively. But when you read this, you're with Debbie, and Debbie has gained great wisdom over the time of her life, and it's been a rough life. So don't miss Extraordinary Contact. Spend some time with it. It's a sacred experience to read it, believe you me. And this is one of the things that, as this experience becomes more and more known and more understood, books like this are going to be the pillars of understanding. So now let's go back, Debbie, to your childhood and you and Katie and some things that happened even back then.
When I was a little kid?
Yeah.
I recall, I was always kind of different anyway. Even my mom would say that later, because I remember, you know, envision this little girl on her glider hanging upside down with her hair dragging in the dirt and her sneakers wrapped around the other side, looking at the stars at night. That's me. And I'm looking up there at the sky and I'm thinking to myself, of all the things in the world that I'm going to do. And I'm thinking, that's it. That I know that there's more. And thinking, feeling like I miss somebody that I've never met or a place that I've never been. And these feelings in me, even as a tiny little kid, and that dream I had about seeing God, I was just me in space. I was space. I was existing. And I saw this white light shatter into a infinite number of shards. And it was my understanding, someone was telling me, that each one of those shards was one of us or of whatever was alive in the whole universe. And this shard was like, one was in me and one is in you. And then when we're done with this experience, this shard comes back out and it goes back and it takes back with it all the experiences we had while we were here. And when we take that back to the big group, the big one, then everyone expands from it. Has, I mean, this when I was a little kid, yeah. Having dreams like this. I don't know a lot of kids that do that, except maybe my granddaughter. But and then when I was with my sister Kathy, I was probably about six. I had an out of body experience, you know, before kindergarten. I was so attached to Kathy. She was like almost 11. She was 11 years older than me and almost more like a mother in some ways. And I was just, I just loved her so much. I wanted to be just like her and be with her all the time. She went down the street to spend the night with a girlfriend one time and I wanted to go so bad and couldn't. No. That I had this dream, which I don't know that it was a dream because it was so real. Suddenly, I remember laying in bed really wanting so badly to be with her. And then all of a sudden I'm in the front yard and the light is weird and different and off, kind of an odd twilight kind of light. And there was a cool breeze blowing on me and someone behind me says, if you stick your arms out and lean into the wind, it will lift you up and you can go where she is. And I did. And I did. And I went into the bedroom and there these girls were listening to 45 records and rolling their hair in orange juice cans and talking and whatnot. This was back in the early 60s, right? And all of a sudden I'm up in the corner of this girl's bedroom watching my sister. And I suddenly got scared. And I remember thinking, oh man, what if I float away and I can't get back home? And the instant that I had that thought, I was back in my bed. The fear took me right back. And I did that spontaneously, just out of sheer desire. It was so strong. And then Kathy, she's the one that I went on that trip with, that she took me with to Detroit when I was maybe six or so, maybe the year of kindergarten, 65, I don't know. And I was actually lost, literally, physically, for real, lost for an entire day at this house that we'd gone to visit these kids. And in my recollection, I kicked the ball over the fence. And when I jumped the fence to get it, as I turned to go back, I was lost. There, suddenly nothing was right. The house was not the same. And I felt like I was lost. And so I went around the front of the house and I saw a door open and I thought, oh, that looks familiar. Like that's where I'm supposed to be. So I walked in this door. House was a jumble. The things looked familiar, but they weren't in the correct places. Like instead of a lamp being on a table, there'd be a chair on the table and a lamp on the floor, you know, just odd things.
Yeah.
And as I started getting scared, I turned around and tried to run out the door, and there was a little boy between me and the doorway, about my age, about my height, and looked human, blonde hair with brown eyes. And he wanted me to stay and play with him and not be afraid. And he said he had all kinds of toys that he wanted to show me. And I calmed down and I'm like, okay. So I went, he took me to a room in this house that suddenly didn't look like this house at all. The room had no corners. The walls were just a soft illumination. There wasn't any lamps, but it was light. And there was an indentation on the floor that I sat on. And I remember one of the cool toys was this box like thing that had what I thought were strings on it that you maybe pluck like a little homemade guitar or something. I remember seeing a red flashing light on the wall and things sliding out of it. Right now my memory gets kind of spotty on it. So, but I think I wrote about it in the book. And, then at some point I'm back in front of the front door, and his mother, or I think it's his mother, comes out from somewhere, big mean woman. And she's mad as hell that I'm there. And she says to this little boy, what is she doing here? She does not belong here. She needs to leave right now. And I literally felt someone shove me out the door, and I'm stumbling on the walkway, and I look up, and there's my sister standing at the end of the walkway on the sidewalk. And all I can remember thinking is, oh, thank God, sissy, you know. And I go to her. She takes my hand. I don't recall her saying a word to me, and walks me back to where I'm supposed to be. And that's it. And then we go home. And then a long time later, when Kathy actually remembered the name of the people, when Bud came for is part of the investigation, he came to visit, they were able to call the woman, who was quite old at that point, but she did remember us being there. She remembered me being lost, and she remembered everyone and looking for me. And she remembered that my sister found me and brought me back. So she kind of correlated, you know, what I had, my spotty memory of it, but, and it was weird because I hadn't even thought about it. And during just conversation with Bud around the kitchen table with Mom and Dad and everybody just sitting around drinking coffee and whatnot, something was mentioned about it. And I'm like, oh, my God, I can't even believe I forgot that whole thing. And then it came back, you know, and then it became part of my history again.
There are so many wonderful words of wisdom in the book. In a world where you aren't sure whom or what to trust anymore, it is supremely important that you learn to trust yourself, your instincts, your power. Your gut will never lead you astray, and the more you trust it, the better it gets. I think that that is centrally important to every close encounter witness. We all have to learn that. And it's hard because the experience is so hard. Now, speaking of hard, what happened that you were really strung out? Now we're flashing forward again from childhood back to the circle in the backyard. And could you describe the soil and what happened to it in more detail?
Well, you know, we never noticed it for a few days after that until the whole family came out on the 4th of July weekend, and we went out there and there was this mark. It was, the circle was only about 8 feet in diameter, or give or take. It wasn't very big. The odd thing about it was it had a long, like 49-foot swath coming off of one edge of it that ended in an absolutely perfect arc. It was only about 2 feet wide on this swath. The grass itself was it wasn't crushed. It was just kind of like it laid down and died. It just was laid over, and it was an odd brownish, dull, almost a brownish gray color. the ground and the soil under it was like a rock. You know, I was about 100 pounds heavier than I am now. And I went out there with a spade, you know, weeks or so later to try to get some samples of this stuff. And I was literally jumping on the spade, trying to dig into it. And I was barely dusting it up, get a little chunk off here and there. You know, I managed to get a bunch of samples though. And some, I still have them. Actually, I still have some, they even survived the tornado, but I think, and I don't remember the exact numbers, like, you don't have to remember when Bud finally did come out to actually physically see it and do his own stuff and take his own samples. It was several months later, but it was still, he had to be baked in the oven. I think it was 800 degrees for 12 hours or 1200 degrees for 8 hours. I can't remember which one it was. A long time to get it to be that dehydrated to where you could take a chunk of this dirt and drop it in a glass of water. And 24 hours later, you would still have a chunk of dirt in a glass of water. And if you did that with any other chunk of dirt, any other place in the yard, you'd have mud. Water, this soil would not accept moisture. Snow melted off of it for the first year. You know, it happened in July, or it happened end of June. And then we get our first dustings of snow in the fall, maybe in November or December. And we get an inch or two of snow on it. And you could literally look out the window and just kind of see this same pattern just kind of start melting. And there it was. It was like this, instead of a crop circle, it was a snow circle. I mean, the same exact thing. It was just the most incredible. None of us had ever seen anything like that ever. And the soil itself had a very odd kind of very subtle, weird smell to it, almost like matches, but very subtle. You know, when I first saw the mark in the yard and started flipping out and having my little nervous breakdown, I was desperate to try and explain it away as something, you know. Also, oddly, there were sewer tiles under it from the septic system on my parents' home. And some of those tiles got broke. How that, underneath that
something,
area.
Something was definitely there. I mean, you combine that with that intense light, and it's a lot of energy involved,
and
for sure.
Dad had a ham radio tower not too far away from it, 100 foot. And there was a bunch of coaxial cables that ran from the tower to the house. And Dad found that in those coax cables were melted.
My
word. He used his antenna for a long time. Yeah, there was a lot of
stuff.
Sounds
like what I do to computers. Melt them all.
That's not good.
No, oh boy, if I didn't recycle or throw out these broken computers, I'd be sitting in a heap of dead computers right now. But now you were very troubled after this happened.
Oh, yes.
Let's talk a little bit about that, the way you felt, and because you couldn't obviously put your finger on what had happened, but something was now wrong.
Right. It all started to come back in bits and pieces once I saw the mark in the yard. That was like my trigger, but it wasn't all fully back. And I was having severe anxiety. I couldn't sleep at night. I would sit up in my children's bedroom in a chair between their beds, or I'd lay down on the floor between their twin beds. But I wouldn't sleep. I was like waiting for something. And I don't know what, but I was going to protect my children. And there was a bathroom.
I know where you're coming from. I was sitting in front of my son's bedroom with a shotgun on my lap for a lot of nights. Go ahead.
Yeah, yeah. Believe me. Yeah, it's something. And there was a bathroom upstairs there. And the window overlooked the mark in the yard. And I didn't even connect that at the time until a little bit later. But I could no longer make myself go to the bathroom in that bathroom at night. And I finally dawned on me is because I felt like something was going to yank me out of the window. And that was the window that overlooked that mark in the yard. Now, and that made sense. I literally thought I was going crazy. And I probably did have a nervous breakdown, I think. Thank you, God, for my parents who realized, you know, I was going through something and they never really, they just were there to help me. They never, you know, said, you know, you're going crazy and we're going to have you committed or all that stuff. They just were like, okay, we're going to do this. And, you know, I'd fall asleep during the day and my mom would watch my kids. I never had to ask her. She never asked me if I wanted to. It just happened like automatic. And I'm so grateful now that my parents were there for me like that. And for my kids, I got sick a lot. I started having rashes and run low grade fevers, and my immune system was shot. It seemed like every cootie that came through Indy, I got sick all the time. And, you know, I was just a mess.
And you did not know why or what Mm-mm. to do about it.
No.
Yeah. Boy, you know, a lot of us have been in that same space. Believe me, I have. And now you're cutting up salad. And you start to suddenly have spontaneous recall. You recall that in the book?
No.
Okay. It's on.
I've done that so many times.
No, you got to watch out for me. I really am into this. And my listeners count on me to be a very careful reader. And I am.
And I'm glad.
Okay. On page 19, I was struck by, let me read the particular passage here. That you were cutting up salad. I'm not seeing it. And you began to spontaneously remember bits and pieces of it. And just instead of the specific thing about cutting up salad, just tell us when you began to recover your memories, when they began to spontaneously come back, and what they were.
First thing I did when I was looking at the mark in the yard, and my mom just blurted out, "Oh my God, that's my," because my nephew says, what's wrong with your yard, Grandma? And she said, "Well, that's where our UFO landed the other night." And I remember looking at my mom and I thought, why did you say that? What? You know, but then it was like something just hit me in the chest. And I just started, first thing I saw were the eyes. I saw the mark in the yard. And over that mark, I saw these big, black, liquidy eyes that just looked into me. And then I remembered being hit in the chest. And in my mind, I thought, I wonder if that feels like what it feels like when you're hit by lightning, you know, right in there.
Yeah.
I even went back and looked at the weather. I went to the National Weather Service and looked back, trying to explain why, you know, maybe I got hit by lightning. You know, then I started to, I remembered other things, not just that night. I remembered back when I was first married in 1978. And these two guys were two big gray-headed aliens came in my bedroom. And I remember being awake and sitting in the bed. And I was terrified. And I thought, and, you know, I remember all this spontaneously. This all came back after that June 3083. They said they had a black box in their hand. And they said to me, I said, well, first I was terrified when I saw them. And I remember saying, don't touch me. Don't kill me, please. You know, don't even, if you just don't move any closer to me, I might be able to hold it together. And then all of a sudden I'm not scared anymore. I'm calm. I'm sitting up in the bed. My ex-husband, my husband at the time, is laying there next to me, sound asleep. This black box comes over to me and I said, what is this? Can I have it? And he said, no, you can't have it. But when you see it again, you'll know what it is and you'll know what to do.
And you did see it again.
You know,
go ahead with this story.
Okay. So, you know, basically that was the end of it. Then they took the box and they went away. And I tried to wake up my husband when I could move, but he wouldn't wake up. And so, of course, I just fell asleep, you know, which to me, thinking back on that now, that's so weird. Why would you just see all these weird things in your room and then just go right to sleep, you know? But I did when I woke up the next morning.
I'm sure a lot of my listeners are nodding and laughing. We all do that.
I know it sounds so crazy. It doesn't make sense to somebody who hasn't experienced it, because it's like, why would you fall asleep ever again? Well, I don't know. That's how it works. But I tried the next morning. I told him, and he said, "Oh my God, what did you eat for dinner last night? Whatever it was, you better never eat it again." And I'm like, that is not even funny. So, and then I called my mother and told her about it. And she recalled how hyped up I was about this. This was in 78, after we were married. And then I had that near-death experience, July 13th, today's date, which is my son's 42nd birthday is today. And that I had that near-death experience where I found myself in the black box.
Yes.
You know, and I
Tell
feel like
how that near-death experience came about. And how you ended up in the black box.
Well, all I ever wanted to be was a mother. And I found out that I was pregnant with my son, Rob, and I was just over the moon. I had had that previous missing pregnancy that devastated me. And so it was like,
we'll
I was trying to get pregnant. Pregnant like every month, you know? So when I found out I was pregnant, I was thrilled. And then the pregnancy was not smooth. I developed preeclampsia that went into eclampsia, and I developed multiple organ failure. I was like in a semi-comatose state, and he was not due for another 6 to 7 weeks, but they reached a point where they had no choice. He actually had more of a chance of survival than I did at this point. It was either do this emergency C-section or I will be dead. So, and I remember the surgeon that did this, the obstetrician who did the surgery was a very devout Catholic. And I woke up enough and he said, "We're going to do this now." And he prayed over me. And I remember that. He said, "Let's pray." And he took my hands. And I'm not a really religious person, you know, but I took it, you know, I just wanted my baby to be alive. And so, we went in and I remember them when they put me to sleep, but I immediately woke back up. I could not move. I was paralyzed, but I felt everything. I felt them cut me open. Pinch, pull, burn, pinch, pull, burn. It burnt like fire. And I could hear them talking. And at one point they were talking about sailboats and Geist Reservoir, which is a reservoir in, you know, near where I lived in Indy, where rich people sailed their boats and whatnot. But I remember hearing that conversation. And then all of a sudden, their voices started to go far, far away. And it got fainter and fainter and fainter until I couldn't hear them anymore. And I physically, literally felt myself disconnect from my body. I disconnected from this box. I felt like I was in a black box. I couldn't see anything. I couldn't see my hands, but I could feel this black box all around me, and it was small and I could feel it. And then I started pounding my fists on it and I was screaming, "I'm not dead. Let me out. I'm not dead. You need to let me out of here." And at that point I heard a voice. Now I think it was a nurse, honestly, thinking back, because I heard a woman's voice say, "Honey, you can't leave now. Your baby is born and he needs his mother." And as soon as I heard that, I was like, I looked back on this body. Because when I disconnected from that body in that moment, I completely forgot about this life or that baby or anything. I just knew I was alive and needed to get out of here. But when I remembered the baby, I locked back in. And then the voices started getting louder and louder and louder. And there was a lot of yelling and banging and hollering back and forth. And later I found out I had coded twice and had to be revived. And I remember suddenly being able to shake my legs, and then a strap went down around them really tightly. And I remember feeling being picked up off the table and put back, like literally thrown back on the table. I could feel all this. But you know what? 7 days later, and this was 42 years ago, 7 days later, Robbie and I went home together. They know he was as early as he was because he didn't have any fingernails or toenails yet. Just little dents where they would eventually grow in.
Yes.
And he had long white hair all over him, and his ears were still folded. He looked like a little pixie. They called him a pixie peanut in the NICU. Oh, but his lungs were fully formed, even though the rest of his body wasn't. The important stuff was. And we both went home 7 days later. And now Robbie, who is today 42 years old, he is my little genius. He literally is. And he's a Microsoft engineer. He is a coder. I mean, he's all about the computer stuff. He's brilliant. So, but that black box, I feel like, I don't know why, I feel the connection between the black box they showed me just, you know, 6 or 8 months prior, telling me I'd know what to do. And then here I find myself in the black box. Yeah. And I believe I could have gotten out if I'd have wanted to, but something, you know, when the girl told me about the baby, I'm like, no, I'm not going anywhere. So
there's something very different about the black box in the sense of most near-death experiences involve an ascent into white light. It's almost as if you were put somewhere where you wouldn't kind of get lost and forget this world. You know, you would want to get out of there. And, mm-hmm. you know, in other words, it was an attempt to keep you from leaving.
Keep me here. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. That's too possibly because maybe I already got out of my body and something snatched me and put me in the box until I could get back in my body.
I think that's exactly what happened because you have not only beautiful children to raise, but a very important mission in this world. And maybe that mission comes from deep within you and deep within the universe itself. Have you ever thought about what you mean? And that's a deep question. I know that. And because you mean something, you're definitely an ordinary down-to-earth person, although very bright. I mean, folks, this is not the work of a person who, she may be humble, but she's extremely skilled writer. You had a mission. Do you know where that might have come from in your past? And Free Dreamlanders, now we are going to take a little break for commercials. And let's trust that you will listen to what they say and subscribe, because we have very few subscribers and very many listeners. And yet this site, Unknown Country, is unique in the world. It is the one place in the world where close encounter witnesses meet other close encounter witnesses and where this is all actually happening. We'll be right back. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle. So, Debbie, what do you think brought this into your life? Is there something about you or your perhaps your past or even past lives? Do you have any ideas?
Yes, I do have some ideas, but they probably sound crazy to people. And
they won't sound crazy to us. You don't have to worry about that.
I get that, though. I understand. But yeah, I feel like I was actually born into this life for this moment in this timeline of what we're about to go through. And I'm one of many of multiple thousands like me. It's hard to put into words. I feel like I have a duty, a destiny to open up people's minds. I don't know if it's because of the contact that I had when I was young, or if it was something that occurred during my formation as an embryo in my mother, you know, but I feel like I have a little extra wiring somewhere that has facilitated me to be able to sense things around me and see things that maybe other people miss. And I just feel like there's this world that we're in now. It's just a tiny little sliver of what is actually going on. And yes. I feel, and I've said this before, and I heard it somewhere, and I don't even remember where I heard it, but it felt so true to me, that human brains are like tube type radios in a Dolby digital surround sound world. And we are only capable of, we can only perceive a tiny bit of everything that goes on around us. If we can't receive it, we can't perceive it. We can't even receive it. It's like being in this room that I'm in right now. There is a multitude of Wi-Fi signals, television signals, radio signals, just all kinds of stuff flying all around me. Just because I don't see it and I can't receive it doesn't mean it's not there. The television can receive the television signal because that's what it's made to do. My brain is developed. My brain is intended to have one kind of experience here. You know, the one that my brain can perceive and receive. I want to wake people up to the fact that there's a lot more out there. That's why I got involved with paranormal research. And two things I wanted to say. I got an EVP. I recorded an EVP probably 30 years ago, 25 years ago. And on it was the clearest voice I'd ever heard in my life. And this old man said, "Are the spirits listening?" And then another voice behind it said, "Can I listen too?" And I had this epiphany that we are the spirit somewhere else too, yeah. You know, and somebody's trying to hear us. And then I had I call it my Roy moment with this big glob of bubbles that my kids were playing with. You know, them big bubble wands that kids with bubbles, soap bubbles, and then they make these huge globs of soap bubbles.
Yes.
My kids were playing with that in the yard one day, and I don't know why, Casey whipped off with this giant glob, and they just all stuck together. And that's when I had my Roy moment. I say Roy from Close Encounters, him and the mashed potatoes. Those bubbles are universes, and each one of those universes is touching, however briefly, how are fleeting, there's a point where they touch. And when they touch, they become one. And it's in that point where communication can be facilitated. And I knew at that moment, there were other people in those bubbles who were aware of us and were working on that side to develop things to communicate with us. Just as I believe there are people on this side, I don't know that I've met them, that are working on actual hardware and stuff to communicate with them. I know that's a fact. I don't know why. I can't prove it. Well, also know enough, there's something.
I have this implant in my left ear, which is hardware and was put in by people on this side, but developed by Constantine Rodave, who is on the other side. So you're absolutely right. I think that intuition is completely correct.
And there's an, I have an extra circuit in my brain. I don't know how any other way to put it. That, like I said, I don't know if I was born with it. I don't know if early physical contact created that, but I know it's there. And just like J. Allen Hynek once told my mother, I don't know that everyone is able to see these things or experience these things yet. Doesn't mean they won't be able to someday, but I feel like part of my job is to trigger that thought pattern in that particular direction that will open this up. And I call myself Johnny Appleseed because I could plant a seed when I speak or when I write. If there was one word or one sentence that I said or wrote that flipped that switch for someone else and sent them off on this quest, then I did what I came here to do.
Well, free Dreamlanders, normally at this time during the show, we say goodbye to you, but I'm not going to do that today. Instead, I'm going to let you go with the whole show because this is a very important show. And Debbie's energy and her experiences are proactive. I can feel the energy, and I'm sure a lot of you can too. And that's valuable energy. It's very valuable energy. Her book is Extraordinary Contact, Life Beyond Intruders. And let's go on, Debbie, to the time that you, how you met Bud and came into his life. Because Bud Hopkins, of course, is the author of Intruders, and Debbie is the subject as Kathy Davis. So tell us about that whole experience.
Well, it was after
we're going to get into Lars too, but tell us first just how you met Bud, and then there's another wonderful story coming, folks.
I got so many. 62 years is a lot of stuff. But, I met Bud because, you know, after the June 30, 1983 incident, I really felt like I was losing my mind, and I was desperate. I wanted to be normal. I didn't want this to happen. I didn't want this in my life. All I could think about was my kids. I had read Missing Time a few months before, kind of picked it up on accident with other books, but I knew what it was about when I started to read it, and I honestly couldn't finish it because every time I try, I'd have a panic attack. But I did know there was an address in the back where you could write to this guy if you thought you'd had these experiences. So I went back to the library and got that book just for the address. And I wrote this like 14-page letter, took a bunch of pictures of the yard. In the letter, I kind of threw my sister under the bus and I told him about her 65 experience she had of a lot of missing time, and one where she recalled, literally, consciously recalled her car being lifted off the church parking lot, her in it, in a giant UFO. So I wrote this letter to Bud, and I started out with her story. I didn't ask her. She was not happy with me. But nevertheless, I did it. And then at the very end, I'm like, oh, and by the way, this happened in the end of June. And all these pictures probably fell out all over the floor when he opened the envelope. I gave my mom the letter and I told her, I said, now you mail this for me when you get a chance. And she's like, okay. And she carried that letter around with her for a couple of weeks, I think she said. And she really didn't intend to mail it at all because she told Bud, I didn't know that I wanted to open this can of worms, which I don't know if she knew more than me or what she knew, but she said one day she found herself in front of a mailbox and suddenly remembered that she had that letter in her purse, and she pulled it out and just something compelled her to drop it in. Anyway, I was out with friends one night and the phone rang. Apparently while I was gone, mom answered and it was him. And so when I came home, I remember her laying on the couch and she said, oh, that guy that wrote that book that you wrote to, he called tonight. Oh, my heart started pounding. My hands were shaking as I dialed.
I can imagine very well.
But I did. And at first I thought, oh, do I want to do this? And then I'm like, And I dialed it. And then I heard his voice. It was all over. That was it. That, and from that point on, you know, began a 3-year investigation. He came to Indiana several times. My first trip to New York, I literally, only thing I owned in the world that was worth anything was my little portable washer and dryer I had in my apartment before I moved. And I sold it to get enough money to buy a bus ticket to go to New York. And then like halfway to New York on the bus, I have this giant panic attack. And I think to myself, what is wrong with you? And I hear my mom's voice, you're a mother. You are leaving your children. You are going off to New York City, you know, big city. I've never been anywhere except with my parents. You're going to New York City by yourself to meet some guy who wrote a book about aliens. And, you know, he could be an axe murderer. He could be crazy. He's probably crazy. He probably is crazy. What is wrong with you? You're crazy. And then I, you know, all these things were running through my mind. And then I came like this close to asking the bus driver, just stop and let me off now. I'll just walk home. Thanks. Out in the middle of nowhere. But when I got off the bus in New York, there he stood with like, I think like a bag of muffins and some coffee or something and big smile on his face. And I thought, well, he looks friendly enough and he has food. So, you know, and I remember my first, my very, you know, on the way back to his place, we rode the subway. And, you know, when you're on the subway, sometimes the lights go off. Jesus, when the lights went off on the subway, the first time I thought I was going to faint. And he reached over. He didn't even look at me. He already knew. He patted me and said, it's okay. It's normal. Yeah. So, but yeah, that's how desperate I was. That is how desperate I was. That is something I would never, ever under any other circumstances in a million years do. That is how desperate I was for help.
Well, you're certainly not alone there. I also ended up in the same situation and went to Bud, and he hooked me up with Dr. Donald Klein, which made all the difference in my life. I'm not so sure I would have had a life. And I think that, by the way, we haven't talked about it, but the split that occurred between me and Bud was a tragic misunderstanding, and he could never get past it. He died despising me, and I have to live with that. And I look often back over my past and try to think, where did I go wrong? How did I do it? But I don't want to talk about that now. What I want to talk about now is what happened to you when you were in New York with Bud. This is so important because it gives you, folks, it gives an idea to any therapist. Bud was not a therapist. He was an artist, but he was willing to do this. He was willing to open his mind to people like us. And The way he made you feel is so important to understanding for anyone who is trying to help people in our situation, to understand how he treated you. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, he did. I mean, his compassion, I mean, he was so compassionate and caring. I was hot off of the bus and we're already headed to Dr. Klamar's office. He had set up an appointment with a psychiatrist named Aphrodite Klamar, which I thought was the most amazing name. Yeah. And she was such a nice woman. And we had a nice conversation and she made me feel very comfortable. We did do an initial hypnosis session with Dr. Klamar, but we didn't do anything. She really just wanted me to feel what hypnosis was really all about, because I had so many crazy thoughts about it in my head from what I'd seen on TV, you know, and I'm like, I don't want to be standing in the middle of, you know, Manhattan naked dancing like a chicken or something like that, you know, and she's like, that's not how it works. So she explained it all to me in terms that I could understand. She took me through the relaxation process and really, I mean, it was so helpful to me just to have that experience. We didn't even really explore anything. We just tried to look, to relax me and loosen me up, but she did. And it was so helpful. And because I was so nervous, just wrapped up all like tight when I got there, just from everything, the trip, but all the stuff that had happened. And then, you know, we spent hours upon hours talking. I drew pictures for him, and he just, you know, got the notebooks out. He introduced me to people. Now, prior to me coming to New York, he had actually set me up with a buddy. I called her Mary in the book, and for the life of me, cannot remember her actual name. But she was a wonderful person. So we met immediately. He brought me together with other people like me, which I had never had any experience before. And then later, I don't know how he got the financing or how it was. My understanding it was donated by someone, the money to take me to a hospital in New York City where they actually did a test on me where they put wires on my head. I think it was called an EEG or something to see if I had like epilepsy. Yeah. And some kind of CAT scan of my brain where I had to sign a release that they put dye in me in case the dye, you know, made me sick, to look at my brain. They wanted to rule out brain tumors, epilepsy, things like that. And then I had psychological testing. There was like 6 hours of verbal and written psychological testing done at this hospital. And the, like I said, I didn't have any money. And I didn't even have any, the insurance I had on me was through my dad at the time. And so I didn't have, you know, any way to pay for this, but Bud managed to either get it donated or have the money donated to pay for it. And I can remember telling the psychologist, you know, it's okay if I'm crazy. I don't mind you telling me that I have an issue, because I know they make pills for that and I will happily take them. If that's what this is, great. Give me the pill, you know. But that's, yeah, the only thing they could say from the testing was that I was of above average intelligence and that I had symptoms of something back then called post-traumatic stress disorder.
Well, we had to stop it. My vision of Debbie was frozen, and I'm not sure that what will come out in the final take on this will be frozen, but if it is frozen for a while, it's not frozen now. So yay. Let's go on.
Yeah.
All right. I think I met you on that journey to New York. I think you had lunch with me, or maybe it was a later journey. I don't know.
I can't remember whether it was that we met the first time or if we met the second time. I can't remember. I do know that I think we first met. Wasn't it like an experiencers, like a little group?
An experiencers group at Bud's house. Yes, that's correct.
Yeah. I'd never been to anything like that before. That was so, it blew my mind and it was so amazing.
Mine too. I had the same experience. It blew my mind. I thought I was alone in the world until I saw Bud's name in a book by Jenny Randles and then met him. And suddenly I found myself in this room full of other experiencers, and it was extraordinary.
Yeah.
And, you know, he had a very definite fixed idea about this being essentially and deeply a negative experience.
That's true. He did.
And I didn't. I did in one sense, because it was very hard for me, my experience, especially in those days. But at the same time, I wanted to make it work and make it useful to me, because I'm not getting out of it. This is the cage this bird is in. And, you know, if I just sit here and suffer, what do I gain from that? That was my attitude. And Bud didn't like the way communion, the tone of communion at all. But tell me, how do you feel now? Because I know you were in the same exact space at that time, because you were being beat up and all kinds of horrible things were happening to you, just like the rest of us. But there's something, there's an amazing sentence in your book that I just, it's on page 128. Let me just get it here. Okay. A very close friend of mine who is also a UFO researcher once asked me how I could not be angry and bitter toward whatever it is that has been messing with me and my family. He felt they'd used me like a lab animal against my will, and that they didn't seem to care about the effects it would have on me. I asked him how he could be sure that's how it really was, that I really was used and then dumped with no regard for my personal health or well-being. Maybe we don't understand their ways, their version of concern or compassion. And Debbie, that's the core of the experience right there, of its arc, from the struggle of what is amounts to a kind of an initiation into a new way of seeing reality, and then through that into a level of wisdom that I think we're here to share with the world. So tell us a little bit about how you went from the struggle of the early days to being able to write a sentence like, maybe we don't understand their ways, their version of concern or compassion.
Yeah, this is so perfect for the conversations that I've been having recently with other experiencers, other people like me. Yes, I was terrified. I was broken. I did not understand the things that were happening around me. And that put even more fear into me. And I'm not saying that I understand it all now. And I'll be a work in progress until the day I check out of this place, promise you. But I was in that emergency room, as they say, of this whole thing. And so was Bud. And I understood Bud was a deeply compassionate and caring person. And he saw all these broken people, and all he really wanted to do was fix us or help us in some way, you know, exactly. And sometimes that wasn't always possible. So I understood his perspective on it, but I also understood that this had to have happened to me for a bigger reason than I can comprehend at this time. This just doesn't happen for no reason. There's something behind this. And I need to find this for myself. I can only speak for myself and my own experiences, obviously. But when I wrote that first book, I wrote with my sister, which a little bit of that is in this, because that's my life and this is my life, and I couldn't delete one, you know, from the other.
No, of course not.
So I know for a fact that there were things that I wrote in that book and things that I've written in this book now that he would not have really been pleased with. But being the man that he was with me, so protective and father-like in so many ways, he wrote a wonderful foreword to it, which I included in this new one. I included the original foreword.
It is quite wonderful. It's a lovely forward for sure.
It is. And I was so grateful to have it, because I knew that there's some things in this, in the conversations that he and I had through the years, there were times when, you know, I would come up with something, or I could tell by his tone or the look on his face that he was like, okay. You know what I mean? He was like, really wasn't feeling it, but he would try to remain a little bit open-minded with me. Yes, his version, his take and his opinion on all of this was much more negative and dark and everything. But I think that came from the people like me who came to him were so tore up, and yeah. it hurt him, you know, in his soul. So, but yes, I started out that way, and my experiences were more of a physical level. They were leaving marks and yards. There were witnesses. There were some medical records. You know what I mean? Things like that. But as I grew as a person, partly maturity and I guess life, we all do that. But and my understanding of my experiences and why I was having them and what they meant, or what they were meant to do for me. I became more aware. And as I lost the fear, the experiences changed and became more energetic in the mind. And my vivid dreaming, my lucid dreaming increased. And I think I know it sounds a little crazy, but I think sometimes I go somewhere when I fall asleep. I go somewhere else. And I do things without this body. And then, you know, I've had, so I've had a lot of experiencers that are still newer or fresher, and they're more angry. And I feel bad because I feel like they think I'm turning all woo-woo on them. And I'm like, truthfully, I think I probably was always woo-woo, but I was terrified of it. And now I'm not afraid. That's the difference. I remember we used to do this thing where we would put a question in our mind and we would think it and say it out loud 3 times and then go to sleep and wake up in the morning with my notepad and write down the first thing that came into my mind. And one of the things I wrote down one time said, fear would slow the process. And that's always stuck in my head. And it seems like the less fearful I became and realizing that, look, I'm 62 years old. Yeah, there's been some side effects, but it wasn't anything malicious, intentional. But overall, I'm a cat with 9 lives and I still got like 5 left. And, I'm doing pretty good and I'm learning how powerful and magnificent all human beings are. I'm beginning to realize and wake up and remember what we really are and what we're capable of, what I'm capable of. And I'm having fun with this and learning this now. And I want other people that are still stuck in the fear. I want to help them. I want to stick my hand out and be that life jacket and say, come on, it's okay. Don't be afraid. I know that sounds crazy, but I feel like that's part of what my job is. And that's part of why I wrote that book.
There are people in the world who bear angels within them that they may or may not know. On your way back from New York, that first trip on the bus, tell us about Lars.
Oh, you know how many people I said, that is such bullshit. When I first told them about it, my good friend Rosemary was like, oh, that's so sweet. She's lonely. I'm like, he is a real person. And Bud found out that he was a real person. It was the weirdest trip I've ever had. You know, coming back from New York for the first time, I was full of emotion and mixed. I was relieved that I found someone who appeared to have some kind of answers and who wanted to help. I was relieved. And I was terrified because I'm going back to Indiana. I felt safe in the big city. Silly little me. I thought I was safe in the big city. And then when I was going back out to Indiana, I'd be a sitting duck again. And they'd come back and they'd be mad because I said something to someone, you know. So I was just full of all kinds of mixed emotions. Going to New York, I was terrified. I think going back to childhood, I've always had this fear of A, being lost, and B, just people that I don't know in general, creepy people. Because even back then, I can feel things from people. I could walk by someone in Walmart and go, ooh, you know, without ever even touching them. If I just get close enough, I just like feel people's energy, and some people are not nice. So, the whole trip down there, I like got my purse wrapped around my neck, clutching onto it, not can't sleep. I'm just afraid someone's going to steal my purse or do something crazy, you know? And I thought, I'm not sharing my seat with nobody this time. And I faked laying down, pretending I was asleep just so no one would sit in my seat with me. And then we stopped the stop, our first stop, this guy gets on the bus. And it's like, I literally feel him. Before he even steps up those steps, I know he's there. I feel him and I get a little tingly. And I remember peeking up over the bus seat and here's this gorgeous human being walking up the steps, looking right at me. And I'm like, I ducked back down real quick. And I remember thinking, oh my God, if I have to sit next to anybody, I hope it's him. Please let it be him. Cause he was just perfect, gorgeous, Adonis, beautiful human being. And I was a young girl, you know, I was in my 20s and still cared about stuff like that, I guess. I don't know. He finagled his way into my seat. The bus was going to be pretty full, and two military guys had come in that were going home, and one sat next to me and the other sat in another seat. And then this guy walks up and he talks to the guy next to me. He says something like, you know, I think you and your friend look really tired. If you would like to have this other empty seat over here, then you two guys can lay down. And if the young lady doesn't mind, I would be happy to sit with her. And I'm like, oh my God, are you kidding me? Yes. Wonderful. Bam. So, you know, and then the whole trip was just amazing and weird and so out of character for me.
Because he started talking about extraterrestrials, and you had never said a thing about that to him.
No. The first thing he says to me, basically in conversation, is, so what, where were you? And I said, I was in New York City. And he said, well, what were you doing in New York City? And I said, well, just visiting, you know, friends and looking into stuff or whatever. And he's like, oh, he threw his head back, kind of laughed and said, the extraterrestrials will love that. And I'm like, what? And, you know, I'm like, what? What? And from that point on, it was like question fest, everything he wanted to know about me. He did tell me, I knew his birthday. I knew that he liked certain things he liked to do. And I knew, and I think I remember asking him why he was where he was. And he said something about, and I can't, it's been so long. Somebody, a friend of his had a child that had brain damage or brain injury, and that he was at a place where they could make the brain regenerate and grow new brain cells. And I'm like, oh, that's really cool. Well, I didn't have any clue about what he was saying. And I didn't know that that wasn't a thing until recently.
No, we have no way of doing that.
Yeah.
So wherever he was, they had very advanced medical capabilities.
Yes. So, you know, and they asked me about my kids and my life. And at one point he reached over and he took my hair was blonde. My hair has been like everything in the book because I'm the hairdresser. At that point, I think it was like blonde and maybe a little bit shoulder length and kind of ratty. And he took my hair and he pulled it back over my ears. And he said, where I'm from, the women wear their hair like this. And he said, you would really look so pretty like that. That looks really nice. And I'm like, from that point on, I think I wore my hair with bobby pins back there for years. But, and now I've cut it that way, actually. And then somewhere down the line, I mean, I noticed that the whole time we were together, he never got up to go to the bathroom. 17 hours. You already know that I probably went to the bathroom a million times. But he never got up to use the restroom. I didn't recall him ever eating or drinking anything. He had a little backpack with him. I don't know what was in it. Maybe it had drinks in it. I don't remember. But I know at one point the bus pulled over on the side of the road in the middle of nowhere, totally dark everywhere. And then the bus driver got out and we could see him in the running lights on the sides of the bus. And then he just kind of walked out in this field. Everybody else on the bus was asleep except for me and him. And I'm like, what in the hell? What is he doing? And he goes, oh, don't worry about it. He's probably just checking the tires. Or I said, well, he just walked out into the field. And he goes, well, you know, maybe he had to use the restroom. I said, there's a restroom like right here behind us. You know, why wouldn't he just come back here and use it? Like, don't worry about it. It's okay. Everything's fine. I'm like, you don't understand though. After this guy started talking to me, it's like I went into some kind of a spell. Literally, I would have followed him to the ends of the earth without question. It was the weirdest thing ever. And eventually the bus driver got back on and off we went. And then we stopped at this weird bus stop in the middle of nowhere. And I thought the bus stop was neat because it was like round, you know, like the nice, neat round buildings with all those windows, and it was lit up and looked really cool. And I'm like, oh, that's cool. And I thought I was hungry. So I got off the bus. I was the only one that got off the bus. Even he didn't get off the bus. the bus driver did. I remember going into this place, and I remember the two, there were three people in there, two girls and a guy, older man. I got a sandwich and something to drink. Everything tasted the same, like cardboard, and had no flavor to it at all, but I was hungry, so I ate it. And they all just stood around and watched me eat. And the bus driver was even in there, and he had a cup of coffee, and he just sat and watched me eat. Huh. And then I went to the bathroom before I got back on the bus. I remember going to the bathroom. When I walked in the bathroom, there was a mirror that faced the door. So when I walked in, the first thing I saw in the mirror would have been me was actually a blonde woman with this like beautiful cobalt stunning blue top on. And I was like, what? And I'm like rubbing my eyes. And when I look again, it's me. And I'm thought, wow, I must be more tired than I thought. So I went to the bathroom and then I got on the bus. And there was some guy got off the bus and was kind of staggering around like he didn't know where he was going. And then he got back on and then we left. Then we got to the bus station in, I believe it was in Columbus.
In Columbus, Ohio. That's right.
Yeah. And that was where our buses, I was going on another bus to Indy and he was going down to Cincinnati. So we were going to part ways, but we had like a little layover thing. And there is a, like a Burger King or something in every bus stop in the United States, like a fast food place. So we went to get something to eat and he didn't know what any of the stuff on the menu was. He had told me he was from near Sweden. He had somewhat, yeah, what Sweden. Is that? And none of that connected with me. I didn't even question it. And he had an accent, but it wasn't like any Swedish accent I'd ever heard. It was very subtle and very sing-songy and lovely, just gorgeous, you know. And it was definitely an accent of some kind, but it wasn't. I hear people with the Swedish accent, and no, he didn't. That's not how he sounded. But anyway, he So I said, well, that's, you know, this is eggs, and the menu was limited in the bus stops. It only had a few things on there. So he's like, well, I'll just take one of everything. I'm like, okay. He was tall. I guess it can hold it all. So as we're eating, I'm thinking in my head, oh my God, I'm never going to see him again and I will die. You know, my heart will break. And he looks up at me like he heard me say that in my head. And he goes, don't worry. I'll find you. I'll come find you again. I promise. What's your phone number? So I gave it to him because I remember thinking to myself, you don't even have my phone number. And then he pops up with, what's your phone number? So I wrote it down. And then he's like, I don't feel good, rubbing his stomach and everything. And I said, I gave him some Pepto-Bismol tablets because I said, probably from all that crap you just ate. Yeah. He's like, well, this is interesting. What is this? And I was trying to explain to him how it worked. And he, can I see the box? And I'm like, sure. So I gave it to him. He read all the ingredients out loud. And he's like, okay, he puts it in his pocket. And I'm like, it is not going to do you any good in your pocket. You need to chew them up and swallow them. He goes, well, I will later. Follows me to the bathroom. He starts to walk in right behind me. And I'm like, whoa, whoa, no, no, you can't come in here. This is for ladies. I said, there's yours over there. I said, see the little skirt? That's me. The little pants, that's you. He's like, oh, okay. I'm like, dude, what do they have bathrooms where you live? When I came back out of the bathroom, he was literally like standing right there at the door. I almost smacked him in the head when I opened the door. But, you know, I got on the bus. I was bawling like a baby. He says, I want you to put your headphones on and turn it on, listen to your music. And he gave me a magazine or newspaper that we'd got. He wanted me to buy him this newspaper. And he said, look at the paper. And he goes, he said to me, I will come back for you someday. I promise there is a long silver trailer near where you live. And I want to take you there and dance with you. And I thought, what? And then I thought, wait a minute. You know, in my head, I used to, when I was home alone all the time, I used to dance. Like I would do it for exercise and music just became me. I vibrated with the music. Vibration is extremely important to me right now in my life and how things vibrate and how they vibrate in my harmony with me, you know, and music. So I would play music real loud and dance all over the house. But sometimes I felt like someone was watching me. And I immediately, when he said, I want to take you there and dance with you, I thought, are you the one that's been watching me? And he never said anything out loud, but when I thought that, he smiled. It was just so freaking weird. And I understand completely why Bud thought I had lost my mind, why Rosemary thought I'd made the whole thing up, until Bud and I did a little bit of self-hypnosis and I remembered his birthday. I remembered the name of the place he told me he was working in Cincinnati. And through a few other little memories I had, Bud was able to find the place, call the guy, Bud spoke to the man who was his friend who had let him come there, confirmed that he was really a human being, but he also told Bud that he was very eccentric. He was very interested in paranormal and UFO stuff, that he had been smitten by me and talked about me a lot when he came back, and that he would disappear for years. Nobody would know where he was. And then all of a sudden he'd just show up out of the blue, like you just seen him yesterday, with no explanation as to where he'd been for the last 2 years. And he said that he'd lived his whole life that way. Now, he came back to me in dreams a few times after I met him that time, you know, vivid dreams. One time I was in the hospital and he showed up there and wanted to know why I was in this place. One time he showed up and said he wanted to take me somewhere, but when I couldn't go, I heard him say, "Oh shit, you can't come yet. You're not ready." And then I tried Googling him for years, the Google, you know, and trying to find this guy. And only I could occasionally find like a picture of a motorcycle rider, but he had a helmet on, so I couldn't see his face. So I wasn't sure it was him or not. Then I find, all of a sudden it pops up one day, a few years ago, a graveyard in Sweden, in this little town on the coast. There's the name, all three names, which Lars is a pseudonym, but all three names that I knew, and the date of birth exactly that I knew from him, and that he had died like less than 2 years after I met him. And all those dreams that I had of him coming back to me were after he had already died. When I realized that that was him and that he had passed away, and all these years that I'd waited for a motorcycle to come down the street, you know, I felt like a foolish old woman. You know, I cried like it was yesterday again. And then I thought, why are you crying? He already came back, you know, multiple times. But it was just such a weird experience. That whole 17-hour bus trip is like a book. Just that.
Just that. Yes. Debbie Jordan Kauble, I want to end the show here. I had planned to end it with the death of Lars, and we have come to that point, and a life of extraordinary contact that goes on to this day. And what is the message, folks, here? There's two messages. We live in a very mysterious universe, but the most mysterious part of it of all that any of us have contact with is us. So value each one that you meet. All human beings are extraordinary, and Debbie is a perfect example of an enormously articulate, capable human being who, as a child, looked up at the stars and now lives there. Congratulations on your book, Debbie. Extraordinary Contact, Life Beyond Intruders. And thank you, folks, for listening, as always, to Dreamland.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.